You're listening to What She Said on Canada Talks.
Hello there. We are back. I'm Christine Bentley here in studio with Kate Wheeler, and our guest is Faith Goodman, who is the founder of Until the Last Child. Good morning, Faith, and welcome.
Good morning. Thank you for having me.
So tell us and all our listeners about The Last Child.
We're a new charity in Canada. We're uniquely focused on something Canadians don't know a lot about, and that is that there are 30,000 children today waiting for a permanent loving home. They're part of the government organization's Children's Aid, and they're ready to be adopted or to find permanency, and it's just a process that is not happening. The issue is about 150 years old, so the basic model hasn't changed since the mid-1800s. And in Canada today, less than 5%, or in that range, find a permanent home every year. And so we're a business group who've come alongside child welfare to say, as a minimum, every child deserves a permanent loving home that can set them up for success. And if this were the business world, a 5 to 7% success rate annually, you know, someone would be asking a lot of questions. So, you know, as I say, we're a business organization, and our model is to come alongside child welfare and support them. And it's been an incredible journey. We have a pilot project in Guelph, and over the last 18 months, that Children's Aid Society has been able to move their permanency up to 44%. So think of this, the national average is around 5 to 7%, and Guelph, that leadership team has changed the game.
So what is it exactly that you do that has made that, you know, almost 40% difference?
Sure. So I think probably the, you know, the lens I could offer is former President Clinton once said, sometimes complex social issues are best resolved when the business community comes alongside community groups and government, and I would liken our example to that model. So what we've done is we provide funding, we encourage innovation and best practices, we provide additional resources to help the Children's Aid measure, monitor. So the kind of the basics that you would think of from a business standpoint, best practices, innovation, technology, measurement, additional funding. And what's been remarkable about this Guelph leadership team, the CEO is a gentleman named Daniel Moore, and his colleagues, Sheila Markle, it really starts with tone at the top. A willingness of that agency to be transparent, to measure and monitor their progress, to think about the finding of homes in a different way, and to truly embrace a best practice, which they did. They've leveraged a model from one from the U.S. and one from Australia. So they've really, you know, I think they've embraced the idea that 100% is possible. And, you know, forgetting about what's happened in the past, saying there is a better way, and we're going to step out and work with this business group and try something different.
But how is that working? Because you mentioned transparency, and
yes,
we know that privacy concerns are a critical issue,
yes,
with the Children's Aid Societies.
Yes.
How did you manage to convince the Children's Aid Society that transparency is something that they could establish?
So I think there's two lenses on transparency. The first lens is information on the child. That is still a absolute no-go zone. So, you know, nobody knows details of the children and their lives. The transparency I'm talking about is the second lens, which is the ability to get numbers, get facts, understand where that child is in the cycle. So once they are declared, you know, available to be adopted, how long does it take from the beginning of that process to the end? And to be able to do what we would do in business, so to manage and monitor the efficiency of that process. So that piece of transparency is really important because if you think about the Canadian statistic of 5% per year, roughly, find permanency, what really happens is most of these kids age out of care mm-hmm. at age 16, 17, and 18. And if you look on our website, we have this really amazing picture called A Vicious Cycle. And what it shows is that for most of these kids, several sad unintended consequences happen. About 44% of them end up homeless. Only about half graduate. They're three times more likely to experience mental health issues and addiction issues, early teenage pregnancy, low employment rates, and then the cycle starts again.
And so that they're more likely to...
Their kids go into care and the cycle starts again. So these are not new statistics. These statistics have been around for a long time. And so, you know, I think what our organization is doing is saying, look, we're not child welfare experts, nor do we ever want to be. We're business people, and we think that there's got to be a different way here. You know, this is an issue that all Canadians should be aware of. These 30,000 kids, you know, every Canadian should know that they're around and that it's they're ours, and we need to help them, and they deserve a permanent loving home at the earliest opportunity, because that's what's going to set them up for success.
Now, you're dealing with kids that are just that are already available for adoption,
yes.
not just in foster care.
Not in foster care,
okay.
Exactly. And so one of the... Sorry, go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, you had mentioned Australia and
yes.
I think the UK.
Australia and the US.
And the US as having certain procedures that are different, that you looked at them to kind of model what some of what you were doing. And what were those differences that
yes.
made it easier?
So I'd say each country or jurisdiction has a piece of something
okay.
that, you know, Canada can look at. And you know, I'm sure other jurisdictions look at Canada and say there's some pieces that others can learn from us. But the two in particular is the one from Australia is called Signs of Safety.
Mm-hmm.
And it's really a program that happens at the beginning of the cycle. So almost even before a child comes into care, you know, what are the measures and opportunities for a Children's Aid Society to actually help the child while they're still with mom and dad or in their family? What supports do they need which minimizes that child coming into care? So it's almost like a front-end piece that happens, a wraparound family service to give that child the best chance not to have to come into government care. The other model from the U.S. is called the family finding model, and it's very, very unique. It's also a wraparound model, and it's a dedicated worker who looks at each of the children and looks at the adults in their lives that they already know,
mm-hmm.
Extended family, teachers, coaches, and tries to identify the 30 or 40 people that child already knows. So instead of a stranger placement, a stranger adoption, this model looks at, you know, who does little Johnny already know? And is there an ability in a very methodical, measured way to contact these people, including extended family and immediate family, and try to make that connection? And because until the last child, our organization provided additional funding,
mm-hmm.
Guelph was able to bring on new social workers looking exclusively at this pilot program. So, you know, it was much more efficient and much more effective, and
mm-hmm.
the results are there.
So let's be blunt, because we hear it all the time, that people only want perfect babies. They don't want any. They don't want anybody that's over two. They don't want anybody that's going to be any kind of, you know, rehabilitative work. So how do you cope with that? Get the message across.
I think what's interesting is that the statistics say something a little bit different. The Dave Thomas Foundation did a study last year that showed there are more than enough Canadians willing to adopt or willing to take a child of any age in. And yet only a fraction of those actually, you know, is there a match made? And so I think what that points to is Canadians want to help, but there's something in that process between
mm-hmm.
the child and the family that wants to adopt or take them in that's blocking, or there's some barriers. And I think that's where this innovation between child welfare and business can really, really, really break that apart and try to enable through more efficient measures that match to happen.
So you're really trying to build bridges.
We are, and we're also really working collaboratively. This issue is not there's not one simple solution. And so it's, you know, to blame or to try to, cast this as one, the government's mm-hmm. issue or someone else's issue. It's ours. And so, again, we like to say that collaboration between the business community, government, academia, and community groups is the way that this is going to be solved. We have to work together.
You're watching What She Said on YouTube.
Well, you've had amazing results from what you tell us in Guelph.
We have.
So we have listeners across this country.
Yes.
And they're probably wondering, well, when does it hit, Vancouver? When does it hit Regina? Is there an ability to move this forward across the country if the results are amazing?
Yeah. Yes. So we have a couple of opportunities. First of all, just to answer your question, several Children's Aid societies across Canada, in Western Canada, in the Atlantic provinces, and others here in Ontario have already come to us and asked us if we could run our pilot programs with them.
Wonderful.
But I think there's a sort of a couple of ways Canadians can help. I think, first of all, over the holidays now, we do have a campaign running called Wrap Your Home. And what we'd like to do is, and there's a hashtag, Wrap Your Home, is for Canadians to wrap your door, gift wrap your mailbox, some tangible sign, coast to coast, that we can say to these 30,000 kids, we know you're there, we care, and this is a tangible sign over the holidays that we haven't forgotten you and we're working really hard to ensure that you get a home at the earliest opportunity. So that's our holiday campaign. And if you go on online or go onto our website, you can either wrap a piece of your home or donate. The second thing is we are really reaching out to corporate Canada. We would like a couple of icon Canadian brands to adopt this cause and join the cause. This is a Canadian issue. It has economic and GDP impacts if it's left unresolved. But most important, it's the right thing to do. How can a country with such vast resources, such a benevolent ethos, how can this be happening right in our own neighborhoods? 30,000 is a lot of kids. That would fill up the Air Canada Centre many, many times. And so, I think at the end of the day, we just come down to the basics and say, this isn't somebody else's problem. This is ours. And we actually have the wherewithal to fix it. It's not that complicated, so let's just do it. And how about a couple of iconic corporate brands step up to the plate and partner with us, adopt the cause, and let's get on with it. We need funding.
How hard is it to go through the process, though, if you want to adopt somebody in Canada? Because as I understand it, you can go through it pretty quickly in another country, but we seem to have a lot of red tape.
We hear that often. And I would come back to, the Dave Thomas study that I mentioned, where it appears that there are ample Canadian families who want to adopt, but there do appear to be barriers. And I think part of the attractiveness of business coming alongside child welfare is to unpack some of those barriers. So, for instance, one of our partners is Deloitte Consulting, mm-hmm. and they've just been outstanding in terms of supporting us. And one of the areas we're working on is how can technology help this issue as well? So, there are lots of levers here that you can use. For instance, how long does it take, once I raise my hand, as if I was a prospective mm-hmm. Mom looking to adopt, how long would it take me today? But what if there was a technology solution that, similar to a... I'll use this as a not a perfect example, but a mortgage application. In the old days it would take X many weeks, and today it takes X hours. Are there technology applications that could help the process of matching? Yes, there are. And we're working with business partners who are trying to look at those opportunities. So you raise a really good point. There are barriers. There are time delays. Mm-hmm. But I think that really is the gravitas of why business and child welfare should be working hand in hand on this. There are solutions. It's not rocket science.
So how do people get in touch with you?
Log on to our website, www.untilthelastchild.com, or our hashtag for our current holiday campaign, hashtag wrap your home, and you can follow us on, like us on Facebook. You can phone us. All of the information's on our website.
And we'll put up the links too.
And put up our links. And please, please join the cause and support these 30,000 kids.
Faith Goodman, thank you very much. Founder of Until the Last Child.
Thank you.
Click the channel subscribe button for full-length interviews and more from What She Said here on YouTube.